بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحافظ said, باب الصلح, the chapter of الصلح. الصلح in the language means when you end an argument. And in the technical terminology, it means a contract which is made by which two disputants come to an agreement and make a reconciliation. And the ruling on الصلح is that it is permissible from the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma' and Qiyas. As for the Qur'an, Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 128, وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرٌ, and الصُّلْح, or reconciliation, is better. As for the ahadith, and they are coming up, and we also have a consensus among the scholars that it is permissible, and also logically speaking, making reconciliation is better because this would be better than fighting and possible bloodshed. And the Prophet said in the Sahihain that even lying is permissible when it comes to reconciliation. As he said, لَيْسَ الْكَذَّابُ الَّذِي يُصْلِحُ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ فَيُنْمِي خَيْرًا أَوْ يَقُولُ خَيْرًا. That the liar is not the one who makes reconciliation between the people, so he increases the situation of the people in goodness, or he says that which is good. So as for reconciliation, then this could be between Muslims and non-Muslims, in that they agree not to be at war with each other, so they will sign a peace treaty. Or even within Muslims, it could be between the Ahlul Baghi. These are the rebellious people who fight against the ruler. So it could be between them and the ruler. So they will sit down and talk with each other and come to some form of agreement. And it could also be between a husband and wife. If you fear that this marriage is going to end up in a divorce or some sort of breakdown, then both parties must strive to make reconciliation. As Allah says in the Quran, that reconciliation is better. As he says, وَإِنِ امْرَأَةٌ خَافَتْ مِنْ بَعْلِهَا نُشُوزًا أَوْ إِعْرَاضًا فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا أَنْ يُصْلِحَ بَيْنَهُمَا صُلْحًا وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرٌ وَأُحْضِرَتِ الْأَنْفُسُ الشُّحَّ وَإِنْ تُحْسِنُوا وَتَتَّقُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا. And if a woman fears cruelty or desertion on her husband's part, then there is no sin on them both if they make reconciliation between themselves. And a sulh is better. And the human self is attracted to being greedy. But if you do good and fear Allah by keeping away from that which is evil, then Allah is well acquainted with what you do. And from the sulh also is between two people who are disputing with each other regarding some aspects of wealth. And this is the type of sulh which is intended in this chapter. Because of course we're talking about financial matters. And making a reconciliation is from the best of the contracts which you can make, because it avoids argumentation and even physical confrontation, and it leaves both party happy. And Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 114, لَا خَيْرَ فِي كَثِيرٍ مِّن نَجْوَاهُمْ إِلَّا مَنْ أَمَرَ بِصَدَقَةٍ أَوْ مَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ إِصْلَاحٍ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ فَسَوْفَ نُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. There is no good in much of their private consultations except those who order charity or good doing or reconciliation between the people. So if you have a secret consultation pertaining to these three praiseworthy matters, and whoever does all of that seeking the pleasure of Allah, then we will give him a great reward. So the sulh which this chapter is talking about is pertaining to financial affairs. And this type of sulh can be further divided into two categories. A sulh pertaining to when a person admits that he owes somebody some wealth. That's the first type. And the second type is a type of reconciliation which is made when a person denies that he owes somebody anything. So let's talk about the first category. This is when one person acknowledges that he owes the other party a right. So this is where a person might say, yes, I admit that I owe such and such a person £1,000. So he admits now that he owes somebody a debt. Or for example, he might say, yes, I admit that I owe somebody this particular computer. So he now acknowledges that he has somebody else's computer. So in the first example, it is a debt, which is his financial liability, so he must pay it off. And in the second example, he's pointing to a particular item. So it's not just any computer, it is this particular specific computer. So in the first example, if it is a debt we are talking about, and a debt is a dain, in a reconciliation, the person to whom the debt is owed might forego some part of the debt, or even the whole of the debt. So this is him simply giving up on some of his right which belongs to him, and he's allowed to do this. Whereas with the computer example, he might say, no, you don't need to, give it back to me, and you can keep it. So when it comes to the computer example, which is a specific object, and this is the Ayn, as opposed to the Dayn, then we say that in the specific object example, so the computer in this case, it would be him giving the other person a gift. So he's gifting this computer to the other person. And he's doing this by not taking back his computer. So when it comes to a Dayn, then a reconciliation pertaining to a Dayn or a debt would be that the creditor is foregoing some or all of his right, and this is perfectly permissible. And when it comes to an Ayn or a specific item, then a reconciliation in this case would be that the creditor is simply giving the debtor a gift, either the whole object as a gift or part of the object. But this is subject to conditions, and there are two of them. Number one, this foregoing of the right or giving the gift must not be something which was stipulated beforehand. So for example, it must not be the case that the debtor will say that I will only acknowledge that I owe you this item or this debt if you forego some of it or all of it. No, this condition is not allowed. Because in this case now, the debtor is forcing the creditor to forego some of his rights. And this is not permissible, clearly. Somebody only foregoes his right out of his own goodwill. However, what if this was to happen? What if, let's say, A owes B £1,000 and he says, I will only admit that I owe you £1,000 if you will forego £100 so that I only have to pay you back £900. And because B wants his money back, he has to agree to this stipulation, then we say that if A pays back £900 because of this stipulation, then we say that this reconciliation contract is only valid for person B. He is the creditor who is going to receive his £900. It is not valid for person A because he is the zalim or the oppressor, because he is forcefully denying person B his rights. Because he's the one who said that I will not admit that I owe you £1,000 except if you forego £100. And this type of condition is invalid. And condition number two, that the creditor, meaning the person to whom the wealth is owed, must be someone who is allowed to give gifts or a charity. And this is stricter than the one who is able to or allowed to enter into a business contract. And the difference becomes known when it comes to the wali of the orphan. The wali of the orphan is allowed to use this money of the orphan to trade if the trade will be profitable. And we spoke about this earlier. But is he allowed to give this money of the orphan as a gift or a charity? The answer is clearly no, he's not. And we also mentioned this ruling earlier. So we find that he is allowed to trade with this money, but he's not allowed to give this money as a gift. So we say that as a condition for the sulh to be correct is that the creditor must be someone who is allowed to give his wealth as a gift, so that he is an adult of sound intellect, and he is a rashid, so he's able to use his money wisely, and he is a free person and not a slave, and also he must not be the wali of an orphan. Likewise, if you're dealing with somebody else's wealth and the owner of the wealth has not allowed you to give this wealth as a gift. So these two conditions must be paid attention to in this contract of as-sulh. So if these two conditions are met, then a person could say that yes, I owe you a particular debt, or that yes, this particular item does belong to you, and I will give you back this item, but can you forego some of this right of yours? And then if the creditor decides to forego some of his rights, without this being stipulated beforehand, then this sulh is permissible. And it is also permissible, according to the correct opinion, that if a person owes another person £100, and this is due to be paid now, but the debtor says, can you please forego £50, and I will pay you the other £50 after 1 month, then this is permissible, as it is a sulh contract. Because if somebody owes somebody a debt because of some money which he borrowed, and then he asks the creditor to give him an extra delay in paying back, then this is permissible. And we can also go the other way around. If, let's say, the debtor owes the creditor £1,000 to be paid back in 1 month, and the creditor says, okay, pay me back the debt now instead of 1 month later. However, if you pay me back now, you only need to pay me back £700 as opposed to the full £1,000. then this is permissible according to the correct opinion. And some scholars, when it comes to the sulh agreement, have been fussy about what wording should be used. They say you're not allowed to use the wording of sulh, so that I make sulh with you. But this is not the case, as there is no evidence for this. Rather, any wording can be used. So you can say, I'm making sulh with you, or anything other than that. If somebody owes another some money to be paid back in a month, and he wants to pay him back this money before the month arrives, then is the creditor to be forced to take this money? There is a difference of opinion, but the correct opinion is that the creditor is forced to take back this money if there is no harm on the creditor in doing so. If there is harm upon him, then he does not need to take back this debt at that particular point in time, and rather, he is allowed to wait until the appointed time arrives. And the debtor may want to pay before the due date because at that particular point in time, he might have much money, and so therefore he's able to pay off the debt. Whereas in the future, he fears that he may lose some of his money. So he does not want to wait until the agreed due date. But the creditor might reject this on valid grounds. For example, he could say, I don't want you to pay the money right now, because right now I'm on a journey and I don't have anywhere to keep this money safe. So I'm not going to take it from you now, because I fear it could be lost. So therefore, I'm going to wait until the agreed due date arrives. So now this is a valid reason for the creditor to refuse taking this money in advance. Is the following sulh permissible? The debtor owes the creditor £1,000 to be paid back after a month. And after a month elapses, the debtor does not have the money to pay back. So the creditor says, okay, we'll have this contract. I will give you another 2 months, but you have to pay me £1,100. We say, no, this sulh is absolutely haram because it is the exact riba which the people of Jahiliyyah were perpetrating. As Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا الرِّبَى أَضْعَافًا مُضَاعَفَةً وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. O you who believe, do not consume riba, doubled and multiplied, and fear Allah, that you may be successful. Or what about this situation? One person agrees with the other that the second person will acknowledge that he is the servant of the first person, whereas in reality they are both free people. This type of agreement is invalid because a free person can never become a servant to anyone else unless he is captured as the war booty. And in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet said, قال الله تعالى ثلاثة أنا خصمهم يوم القيامة رجل أعطى بي ثم غدر ورجل باع حرا فأكل ثمنه ورجل استأجر أجيرا فاستوفى منه ولم يؤته أجرا. That Allah says that there are three types of people whom I will be their adversary on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Number one, a person who takes an oath in my name and then he proves to be treacherous or deceitful. And number two, a person who sells a free man and then he consumes his price. And number three, a man who hires another person and he makes him do the full work but does not give him his due wages. So it becomes known that these three types of acts are major sins. Or what about this? If a man and woman agree that they will be husband and wife, and they might enter this agreement because the state gives married couples extra money than single people. So this type of contract is haram because it is not a valid nikah contract. And if they are officially married in this way, but actually they're not married, then this means that the man is entitled to inherit from the woman, outwardly speaking, but in reality, he's not allowed to inherit because he's not married to her in reality. And also, if this woman becomes pregnant from another man, then this child will be attributed to her quote-unquote husband, whom she agreed with that they will be husband and wife. And clearly, this is evil. You cannot attribute somebody else's child to another man, and hence completely rupturing the lineage. And in a case like one of these two, if, let's say, a person wants another man to acknowledge that he is the servant of the first man, and the second man refuses to acknowledge this, and then the first man says, you will acknowledge, because if you don't acknowledge this, then you must pay me £1,000. And the second man, in order to save himself, pays this £1,000. So if the first man receives this money, then this is haram money which he is receiving, and he will be taken to account for this, as it is eating up people's wealth without due right. So that was the first type of as-sulh, which is when one party acknowledges that he owes the other party something. either a debt or a particular specific item. Let's move to the second category of as-sulh, which is when one party denies that he owes the other party something. So person A says to person B, "You owe me £1,000," and person B says, "No, I do not." So this is a denial. But then they make a reconciliation treaty, and B gives A some amount of money. Or for example, if A claims that B has his computer, and B denies this, then again we have a situation of a denial. And even in this case, they can make a reconciliation by person B giving person A something. So for example, instead of him giving back the computer, he might give him some money. But the question is this sulh contract a sales contract in reality or not? We say, from the standpoint of view of the one who makes the claim, so person A is claiming that person B has his computer. Person B denies it, and they make a sulh contract in which person B gives person A £200 to settle the dispute. So here, as far as person A is concerned, this is actually a trade contract, because from his standpoint of view, £200 have come into his possession and his computer is taken out of his possession. And this is exactly what a trade contract is. So this is now not a case of person A letting go of some of his rights, which was the issue in the first type of sulh, when person B acknowledges that he has something which belongs to person A. But in this case, it is no longer person A giving up on some of his rights or all of his rights. Rather, it is a trade contract as far as person A is concerned. So notice the difference. As far as person B is concerned, then from his side, it is a case of person B letting go of some of his rights. Because person B says that this computer does not actually belong to person A, but he's giving him £200. So he's letting go of his £200, so he's letting go of some of his rights. So from the standpoint of view of person B, it is not a trade, it is simply him letting go of some of his rights. And because from the point of view of person A, this is a sales contract, then if we have a case like this, that A claims that B owns his tape recorder, and B denies this, and they make a sulh contract by person B giving person A a radio, then if person A finds this radio to be faulty, then he has a choice to return this item. Because remember, when we were talking about a choice, we said that if an item is faulty, then the buyer has the right to return the item. And because it's a sales contract, a shufa does apply. So if A claims that B has his car, and person B says, "No, this is my car," and then as a sulh contract, person B gives part of his land to person A. But the point is, person B shares in the ownership of this land with his partners. Now we know in shufa that the partners have most right to take this land if their partner sells it. So in a case like this, because this sulh contract is a trade transaction from the standpoint of view of person A, the partners of person B do have the right to take this land from person A. So in other words, the partners of person B have most right to buy this land which person B is giving away, if it is a trade contract. And in this case, it is a trade contract in reality. So these partners will simply pay the price to person A and take the land. However, in a scenario where there are, let's say, 10 people who own a piece of land, so they are sharers in this land, then person A comes along and he says that the share of the land belonging to person B actually belongs to him. Person B denies this. So they enter into a dispute, and as a sulh contract, person B gives person A £5,000. The question is, do the other sharers of person B have the right to take this £5,000? The answer is no, because in this case, the land which belongs to person B is not entering into the ownership of person A. Rather, what's happening here is that person B is simply giving person A some money, and that's not the same as the actual land in which these 10 people share the ownership of. What happens in a case if one person is lying? For example, person A says that person B has his computer, and person B denies it, and they make a sulh contract, and person B gives person A £100. Is it permissible for person A, who was lying in his claim, to take this £100? We would say no, it is impermissible for him, and this would be usurping somebody else's money. In a case of a stealing, if a person steals somebody else's wealth, then this wealth, let's say some jewelry, is lost. from the possession of the thief, and the thief admits that he stole the other person's wealth. And then as a compensation, the thief enters into a sulh contract with the person he stole from, and he gives him some wealth in return, then this type of sulh is permissible. However, it needs to be noted here that if it's the case that this thief is caught by the one from whom he stole, so person A steals from person B, and person B catches person A, and person B wants to take this thief to the court, so he has his hand cut off, and person A says, "Don't take me to court, I'll enter into a sulh contract, I will give you some wealth, and we can end this affair." In this case now, it is not permissible to enter into a sulh contract. Rather, what person B is allowed to do is, either he takes him to court so the punishment can be established, which is the cutting off the hand, or person B simply forgives person A and lets him go, and conceals person A's faults. But as for making a sulh contract, then this is not permissible, because you're not allowed to make a sulh contract in avoiding the had punishment. And if we allowed this to happen, then the had punishment would never be established, because the criminal will always escape with a sulh contract. And the difference between this scenario and the first one was that in the first one, the thief himself acknowledged that he stole the wealth, and the wealth which was stolen has been lost, and he wants to compensate the person from whom he stole. As for in this second scenario, the thief is caught, and with this sulh, he's trying to get away from the had punishment. Do not forget that the had punishment, as well as being a right of the one who has been wronged, is also the right of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And so sulh cannot be made with Allah. Sulh is made between two people. Similarly with al-qadhaf. And this is when one person accuses another of zina. So if A accuses B of zina without producing four male just witnesses, then person B can take person A to the court and have him flogged 80 lashes. So he's going to do this, but then person A says, "Please don't take me to court, rather I'll pay you some money and we can end the affair." So this will be our sulh contract, or our reconciliation. This is impermissible, because you're not allowed a sulh contract in order to avoid the had punishment. So what person B must do here is either take him to court or forgive him and overlook person A's fault. And in fact, some scholars are of the opinion that this person who has been accused of zina does not have the right to forgive the person accusing him of zina, and that this right is solely for Allah, and hence if qadhaf is performed, then the punishment must take place, even if the maqdhuf forgives the qadhif, meaning to say, even if the one who is accused forgives the accuser. But we say that the one who is accused, the maqdhuf, does have the right to forego the accuser, and this is a far more flexible opinion. And some scholars say that in a case like this, the accused is allowed to forgive the accuser by taking some of his wealth, so by a sulh contract. Because the point is that the one who is accused, his reputation now has been blackened, and he has the right to receive some financial compensation for this. So we see that there is a difference of opinion on this issue. Is the qadhaf exclusively the right of Allah being violated, or is it also pertaining to the right of the accused? So this is the debating point. What about this scenario? A person divorces his wife in front of two witnesses. Then afterwards, he denies that he divorced his wife, because maybe he wants to keep her. And the woman says, "But I have two witnesses who witnessed you divorcing me." So the husband goes to the two witnesses and he says to them, "I will give you £1,000 each, and in return, you do not testify that you saw this divorce." So is this type of sulh permissible? The answer is no, it is not. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَةَ وَمَنْ يَكْتُمْهَا فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُ. And do not hide the witnessing or the testifying, and whoever hides it, then he is of a sinful heart. So you cannot have a sulh for something which is haram. Likewise, it is not permissible to pay somebody to testify falsely for you. So to testify to something which he did not see. Because this is shahadatul zur, false testifying, and it is a major sin. Other issues pertaining to reconciliation between people. What happens if a tree in a person's garden, or the branches of a tree, enter into his neighbor's garden? We say in a case like this, the neighbor must demand from his neighbor that he removes this branch, because it is encroaching on his property. If the neighbor refuses, then he has every right to remove it himself, because what is on his property belongs to him. They could enter into a sulh contract, so the person whose tree is encroaching the rights of his neighbor, he could say, leave the tree alone, don't remove it, and as a recompense I will pay you a percentage of fruits from the tree. And this is permissible because now, if they agree to this, then there is no harm upon anyone. If he wants to pay him some money, then for this to be permissible, it would depend on how much area the tree is transgressing in the neighbor's property. Because if the money is fixed, then the problem is that over time the tree will occupy more and more area. And so therefore this would require more and more price to be paid. So if the price can be agreed per area, then there is no jahala involved here, because you know how much you're receiving for the area of the tree which it is occupying on your garden. And also, if your house is on a street, then is it permissible for you to put items on this street, like perhaps house items which you are no longer in need of, or perhaps throwing water into the street which you have used for washing? We say in all of these affairs that if there is no harm to other people, then it is permissible. So perhaps if the street is wide and you're not going to cause inconvenience to people who are walking, and especially if it is customary amongst people to do this sort of thing, then we say it is permissible. And you find this sort of thing happening a lot in many countries, in which people will throw out used water or other household items which they are no longer in need of, they will put it in the street. So as long as this is not causing any harm, then it is permissible. You can often find drain pipes coming out from the house and taking water out into the streets. So as long as there's no harm in this to the people walking by, then this is permissible. What happens if two neighbors own a property, let's say a water wheel, and this water wheel gets damaged and one of the neighbors wants to fix it? We say he is allowed to force the other neighbor to contribute to fixing this water wheel, because both of them own it. However, if one of the neighbors wants to do something which is not necessary to the water wheel, and rather it is seen as a luxury and not a necessity, then he is not allowed to force the other neighbor to contribute. For example, if they both share in a river, and one of the neighbors wants to expand the river, then he's not allowed to force the other neighbor to contribute, because this is not something which is necessary, rather this is more of a luxury item than a necessity. However, if the shared item is damaged, then this is a case of necessity, and hence both of them must contribute if they both share in the ownership. Hadith 747. وعن عمرو بن عوف المزني رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الصلح جائز بين المسلمين إلا صلحا حرم حلالا أو أحل حراما والمسلمون على شروطهم إلا شرطا حرم حلالا أو أحل حراما رواه الترمذي وصححه. From Amr ibn Auf al-Muzani, the Prophet said that الصلح or reconciliation between the Muslims is permissible except the type which makes something halal into haram or something haram into halal, and that the Muslims must keep to their conditions which they make between themselves, except the condition which makes something halal into haram or something haram into halal. The hadith is sahih. So we find in this hadith the Prophet is saying that sulh between the Muslims is permissible. Does this then mean that between a Muslim and a non-Muslim it's impermissible? The answer of course is no, and that a sulh between Muslims and non-Muslims is of course permissible. We have peace treaties being signed between a Muslim state and a non-Muslim state. But the hadith here is talking about what is most common in a Muslim society. And that is to say, you have reconciliation contracts between two Muslims. And so the asl with the sulh is that it is permissible, except if it entails something which is impermissible. For example, if there is a dispute between a husband and a wife, and this man has two wives. So the wife with whom he is having a dispute, she says, let's make a reconciliation between ourselves, and to do this, you will divorce your second wife. So if they make a reconciliation on this condition, then do we accept it? We say no, this is haram. Because although making reconciliation is not only permissible, but recommended in a case like this, as Allah says, وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرٌ, and the reconciliation is better, but this sulh goes against the hadith which we have come across, in which the Prophet forbade a woman to ask for the divorce of her sister in order to empty out her provision or deny her her provisions, because her provision comes through her husband. Or for example, if two people are having a dispute and they make a sulh and one person says that I will give you my servant girl, then this is impermissible, because this servant girl is not a mahram to this man, and he's not allowed to have intercourse with her. So a man is not allowed to give his servant girl to another man. What about if two people make a sulh in which one of them will not eat bread for one whole week? Is this type of sulh permissible? In this case, we have to see if there is a benefit in doing so, then we say it is permissible. Or for example, entering into a sulh contract in which somebody is going to give a false witnessing. And this is the shahada to zur, and it is impermissible. And as we said before, that a sulh is permissible not only in financial matters, but in all types of affairs in which you can have disputes. So for marriage affairs, a sulh applies. And also with regards to blood affairs. And it even applies in those situations in which the right which belongs to someone else is unknown. So for example, between two people, they have been conducting transactions for a long time, and person A owes person B much wealth. But because a long time has passed, they have both forgotten what exactly it is. But they do know that person A owes person B. So they can make a sulh contract. They can agree that person A will give something to person B to settle the affair. So if they both agree to this, then it is permissible. A sulh can also work in blood money affairs. If somebody injures or maims another person without due right, then the one who has been wronged is allowed blood money, or he can retaliate. If it's a case of intentional killing, then the relatives of the killed can demand a higher blood money, because this killing was intentional. And if the perpetrator does not want to pay, then the relatives can always have the perpetrator killed. A haram type of sulh would be when somebody forces another person to enter into a sulh contract. And a typical example of this could be a husband treating his wife badly so that the wife gives him back the mahr and frees herself from him. Meaning to say, she demands a khula by giving back the mahr. And Allah forbids this. He says, وَلَا تَعْضُلُوهُنَّ لِتَذْهَبُوا بِبَعْضِ مَا آتَيْتُمُوهُنَّ. And do not treat them badly so that you take away what you had given them. Meaning to say, so that you take away the mahr. And the mahr which the husband gives the wife is in order to make the wife halal for him to have intercourse with. So this is why Allah Jalla wa'ala goes on to say, وَكَيْفَ تَأْخُذُونَهُ وَقَدْ أَفْضَى بَعْضُكُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ وَأَخَذْنَ مِنْكُمْ مِيثَاقًا غَلِيظًا. And how can you take it? Meaning to say, how can you take back this mahr when you've had intercourse with each other and the wives have taken from you a firm covenant? So the point is that Allah is saying that you've had intercourse with them, which is why you gave them the mahr, and now you want to take back this mahr, which made the intercourse halal for you. So it's like you having your cake and eating it. So this idea of treating your wife badly so that she becomes fed up with you and wants to leave you by giving you back your mahr and thereby leaving you with the khulu' is not permissible except if the wife herself has a bad character and she does not observe the rights of the husband over her, and she has a bad attitude, or perhaps she does not perform her salah or her obligatory duties both to Allah and to the husband. So if she is this type of woman, then it is permissible for you to mistreat her in a way which she will become fed up with you and give you back your mahr. Because the point is, if you divorce her, you're not allowed to take back the mahr if you had intercourse with her. So the point is here that the man wants his mahr back. And in this particular case, with the woman having an attitude problem, it is permissible for the man to treat her wife in such a way where she will become fed up with him and would want to part with him by seeking a khulu'. And from this also, if the wife commits a zina with another man, then it is permissible for her husband to treat her in such a way in which she will become fed up with him and want to part company by seeking a khulu'. As Allah Jalla wa'ala says, إِلَّا أَن يَأْتِينَ بِفَاحِشَةٍ مُبَيِّنَةٍ, except if they perform a plain immoral sin. So as for fahisha, which is mentioned in the ayah, it could mean zina, but it could also mean speaking to the husband rudely and not giving him his rights. And fahisha in this case is likely to be general, so it includes all of these things. What about this example? Person A owes person B £1,000 after 1 year. Then after only 6 months elapse, he says that I will give you £800 now, as long as you forego the rest of the £200. So if they agree to this, then is this permissible? The answer is, according to the correct opinion, yes, it is permissible. And this is not deemed to be a sales contract. Rather, it is simply person B foregoing some of his rights. And it is not a riba. And in this, there is a benefit for person A because he gets to give back less money. And there is a benefit for person B because he gets to take back his money earlier on. As for the shurut or the conditions, then these must be fulfilled. As long as these conditions don't go against the Quran and Sunnah. As Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ. O you who believe, fulfill your contracts. Likewise, I'm saying, وَأَوْفُوا بِالْعَهْدِ إِنَّ الْأَحْدَ كَانَ مَسْؤُولًا. And fulfill the agreements will be questioned. So making conditions in your contract is permissible. And if you agree to them, then you must uphold these conditions, except those conditions which are haram to be made. For example, a condition that the seller says, you will give me your son as a rahan, or a pledge. And we said before, it is impermissible to give a free person as a rahan, because you're not allowed to sell a free person. What about this condition? He says, I will sell you this item on the condition that you will not have intercourse with your wife for 1 week. Is this condition permissible and to be respected? The answer is yes, this condition is permissible. And this is not making haram what is halal for this man. Rather, this is simply this man not doing what is halal for him. This is as opposed to giving a free person as a rahan, because this is haram in and of itself. Whereas not having intercourse with your wife is not haram in and of itself. What about a case where a person claims that the other owes him £1,000, and in this claim he is lying? Then as for the other party, he fears that this claimant is going to take him to court. So he says, okay, don't take me to court, and let's make a sulh contract. I will pay you £800 instead of £1,000, and we'll settle the affair. If they agree to this, then this contract from the side of the one who paid the £800 is correct. But as from the side who takes this £800, and remember, this was the person who was lying when he claimed that the other owes him £1,000, then we say it is haram for him to take this money. Because in this case now, he is a zalim or an oppressor who is consuming people's wealth without due right. Can we have a sulh between Muslims and non-Muslims? The answer is yes, and the most famous example is the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah. And as for those conditions which are batil, so they oppose the Qur'an and the Sunnah, then we say that the contract can go ahead, but the condition must not be respected. And the example to illustrate this ruling is the case with Barira, which we discussed. The Prophet went along with this invalid stipulation that the wala of Barira would be for her previous owners, and so Aisha bought Barira for 9 uqiyah. But then after that, the Prophet annulled this condition. But he did not annul the trade transaction in which Aisha bought Barira. And the Prophet clearly said that all the conditions which are not in accordance with the Sharia, then they are batil, even if you emphasize these conditions 100 times. Hadith 748, وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يمنع جار جاره أن يغرز خشبة في جداره ثم يقول أبو هريرة ما لي أراكم عنها معرضين والله لأرمين بها بين أكتافكم متفق عليه. From Abu Huraira, the Prophet said that a neighbor should not prevent his neighbor from planting a wooden beam on his wall. And then Abu Huraira told the people, why is it that I see you turning away from this hadith? Wallahi, I will throw it between your shoulder blades. Muttafaqun alayh. So this hadith explains the rights which a neighbor has over his neighbor. And it is saying here that a person is not allowed to prevent his neighbor from placing a wooden beam on the wall, which they both share. Or that perhaps he might want to bore a hole in the wall and fix the wooden beam in this wall. And the reason why he's not allowed to prevent his neighbor from doing this is because with this act, there would be a benefit for his neighbor and there would be no loss for him. So in something which brings about a benefit for someone and it does not bring about a loss for anybody, then this sort of thing should not be prevented. In fact, it could bring about a benefit for both sides, because if you own this wall, then if he places a beam on it, then this could strengthen the wall, especially in those days where the walls would be made out of mud. However, if it's the case that your neighbor planting a wooden beam on this wall is going to damage the wall or cause some sort of harm, then you do have the right to prevent him. because of the generality of the hadith, لا ضرر ولا ضرار. There should be no giving out or receiving harm. Abu Huraira, who is reporting this hadith, saw the people were not too keen on implementing this hadith. And Abu Huraira was the leader of Al-Madinah at that time. And so he told them, why are you turning away from this hadith? By Allah, I will throw it between your shoulders. So he's saying that even if you don't like this ruling, I will put the wooden beam on your necks if I have to. Because the law of the Sharia must be implemented, whether you like it or not. Of course, it does not mean to say that Abu Huraira was going to implant a wooden beam in the necks of the people, but this is by way of telling them off that they should not be turning away from the ruling of the Sharia, and that it is obligatory upon them to accept it if they are Muslims. And he could give them a warning like this because he had authority over them, because he was the Amir of Al-Madinah at that time. His statement could also be understood as, I will throw this sunnah between your shoulders, so that I will keep on reminding you of what the ruling is. And from this then we can take, becoming angry for the sake of Allah, it is from the ways of the Muslim. He becomes happy and angry for the sake of Allah. When he sees that the rights of Allah are being violated, then this is something worth getting angry about. There are many scholars who say that it is not permissible for a person to prevent his neighbor from fixing a wooden beam on his wall if it is necessary for his other neighbor to fix this beam because he wants to build a roof. So they say that this hadith applies in a case of necessity, where a person is not able to build a roof except by fixing a beam on this wall of yours. However, the hadith appears to be general. So it appears to be the case that this ruling applies whether in a case of necessity or not. So at any time your neighbor wants to fix a beam on your wall for a need, you have to allow him as long as there is no harm on you, nor on the wall. And from the behavior of Abu Huraira, we can also take that you can be soft when the situation calls for it, but you need to be harsh when the situation calls for it. So a leader needs to hold all of these traits, being soft when it is appropriate and being harsh when it is appropriate. And we can also take that it is permissible to use words of exaggeration when you are telling people off. Because clearly Abu Huraira was not going to throw these wooden beams on the necks of the people, meaning to say between their shoulder blades. But this is an exaggeration, so that the people will be in no doubt that Abu Huraira is serious about the ruling which he is giving. As for your neighbor, he has many rights, and his rights are greater than what people may think. And the Prophet ﷺ said, وَاللَّهِ لَا يُؤْمِنُ مَنْ لَا يَأْمَنُ جَارُهُ بَوَائِقَ. Wallahi, he does not have full iman, the one whose neighbor is not safe from his harms. So the Prophet here has negated your iman if your neighbor is not safe from your harms, so that you are annoying him all the time. Perhaps you are parking your car in his driveway, or maybe you're leaving litter on his driveway or on the path. Or perhaps you make too much noise, which disturbs the neighbor. All of this is a major sin. So is this prohibition in the hadith denoting the ruling to be makruh or muharram? We say it is muharram, because Abu Huraira became extremely angry when the people did not accept the ruling. The madhahib of Abu Hanifa, Malik and Ash-Shafi'i, they say that if it is possible for the person to build a roof without putting a beam on the wall of his neighbor, then it is permissible for the neighbor to prevent him from placing the beam. And their evidence is, لَا يَحِلُّ مَا لَمْرِئٍ مُسْلِمٍ إِلَّا بِطِيبَةٍ مِّن نَفْسِهِ. It is not halal to take the wealth of a Muslim person except by his goodwill. As for Al-Imam Ahmad and the scholars of Hadith, they say, no, it is still obligatory for you to allow him to place the wooden beam on your wall. And if this neighbor refuses, then the ruler will have to force him to allow his neighbor to plant the beam on the wall. Of course, this is on the condition that there is no harm on this wall. And for their ruling, they use this hadith. And they say that Abu Huraira understood this hadith as an obligation, and his understanding is far better than ours. So we have to understand it the way he did. And a similar situation occurred during the Khilafah of Umar. A man called Al-Dahhak ibn Khalifa asked a man called Muhammad ibn Maslama to let the water from his garden run onto his garden, meaning from Ibn Maslama's garden to the garden of Ibn Khalifa. But Ibn Maslama did not allow this. And this refusal from Ibn Maslama was unreasonable, because the point is that there is simply no harm on Ibn Maslama if he lets the water run onto the garden of Ibn Khalifa. And in so doing, there would be a benefit for Ibn Khalifa. And so for Ibn Maslama to refuse is simply unreasonable. There is no valid reason for his refusal. And it appears he's only refusing just to be difficult. And so the case went to Umar, and Umar told Ibn Maslama, لَيَمُرَّنَّ وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ بَاطِنِكَ. The water will surely run, even if it is on your belly. And this firm conviction from Umar is understandable, because there's no way you can prevent a matter like this, in which there is no harm upon you, and the only thing which it will lead to is a benefit for somebody. So the point is that the rights of the neighbor must not be underestimated. Hadith 749, وعن أبي حميد الساعدي رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يحل لامرئ أن يأخذ عصا أخيه بغير طيب نفس منه رواه ابن حبان والحاكم في صحيحيهما. From Abu Humayd al-Sa'idi, the Prophet said, it is not halal for a person to even take a stick of his brother except with his goodwill. The hadith is Hasan. So we learn from this that you taking the wealth of your brother without him being content is you consuming his wealth without due right. And in the famous hadith, the Prophet did say that your wealth, your blood and your honor are haram, as the hurma of this day of yours, meaning the day of Eid, in this month of yours, meaning Dhul Hijjah, and in this city of yours, meaning Mecca. Of course, there could be exceptions to this, for example, the rahan. If somebody gives a rahan and he is unable to pay back the debt, then it would be permissible for the one who has taken the rahan to take the case to the Khalifa, and the Khalifa will sell this rahan off to recover the debt, even if the owner of the rahan is not pleased, because now we are selling his possession with due right, as opposed to without due right. The hadith specifically mentions a stick, and this is only by way of an example. Otherwise, the same ruling applies to all types of wealth, even if this wealth is smaller than a stick. You'll notice that Al-Hafidh has put this hadith after the hadith of Abu Hurairah. It is as if he is indicating to the Shafi'i madhab, as well as the madhab of Abu Hanifa and Malik, and as we mentioned before, they all say that if this man can build a roof without placing the beam on the wall of his neighbor, then it is not permissible for him to place the beam without the permission of the neighbor. And their evidence, as we stated before, is this hadith. But in response, we simply say that this hadith is not in accordance with its generality, rather, it has exceptions which are made. And from the exceptions which we mentioned are rahan. It is permissible to sell this rahan even if the owner of the rahan dislikes it. Or for example, the husband is not spending on the wife. It is permissible for the authority to forcefully take the wealth from the husband and give it to the wife, because this is an obligation for the husband in the very first place. So even if the husband now is not happy, still it does not matter. And also from the exceptions is that a person is allowed to place a wooden beam on the wall of his neighbor, and his neighbor is not allowed to say, no, you cannot do this because I am not content with it. We say no. The Sharia makes an exception to this general case where no one is allowed to take the wealth of the other except with his goodwill. And on this topic of taking other people's wealth, you need to know that if you were to take other people's wealth, then of course this is haram, but as part of your tawbah, you would have to return this wealth. And your tawbah could not be complete without this. But now the question is, how do you know that this person is happy with you taking some part of his wealth? You can say, well, you have to ask him, do you not? True, but do you always have to ask this person? The answer is no. Sometimes you could have indications which tell you that he would be happy for you to take some part of his wealth, even without asking. For example, if somebody is a close friend or somebody is a near relative and you were to take something of his possession and you know that this person would not mind, then it is permissible for you to take it, even if you did not verbally ask for his permission. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah An-Nur, Ayah 61, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْرَجِ حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيضِ حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى أَنفُسِكُمْ أن تأكلوا من بيوتكم أو بيوت آبائكم أو بيوت أمهاتكم أو بيوت إخوانكم أو بيوت أخواتكم أو بيوت أعمامكم أو بيوت عماتكم أو بيوت أخوالكم أو بيوت خالاتكم أو ما ملكتم مفاتحه أو صديقكم. There is no restriction on the blind, nor on the lame, nor on the sick, nor on yourselves if you eat from your houses, or that of your fathers or your mothers, or your brothers or your sisters, or the houses of your father's brothers or father's sisters, or mother's brothers or mother's sisters, or from those houses which you hold the keys to, or the house of your friend. And this is because when it comes to these family relations, or if somebody's a close friend of yours, then it is permissible for you to go into their houses and eat from it, because the fact that they are your close family members or a close friend is an indication enough that they are going to allow you. But as for somebody whom you do not know very well, then you would have to ask for his permission. But generally speaking, other people have great rights over you. And one of the best hadith to explain this, in Sahih Muslim, a man comes to the Prophet and he says, "Inform me, if I am killed in the way of Allah, will my sins be forgiven?" The Prophet said, "Na'am, illa ad-dayna, fa inna Jibreel qala li dhalik." The Prophet said, "Yes, except your debt which is upon you, because Jibreel has just informed me of this." So we find that the shaheed has all his sins expiated from him, except the debt which is upon him. So you can see the great rights which other people have over you, and in particular the great rights of the creditor. So we find in the very first place, you should try to avoid taking out a debt. Then Al-Hafidh said, بَابُ الْحَوَالَةِ, the chapter of transferring a debt. In the language, Al-Hawala means moving from one place to the other. And technically it means transferring a debt from one person to another person. And this is permissible from the Sunnah of the Prophet and also sound reasoning. And the justification is because sometimes people have a real need to do this. So for example, if person A owes person B £100, but person C owes person A £100 as well. So person A says to person B, "Okay, I owe you £100, but person C owes me £100. So instead of taking the £100 from me, because I don't have this right now, why don't you go to person C and take it from him?" So this is al-hawala. Person A has referred his creditor, person B, to his debtor, who is person C. Some scholars say that this is a sale of a debt. So person A is owed £100, and this has not come under his guarantee, because it is with person C. But this £100, person A gives it to person B, and person B will recover it from person C. But Ibn al-Qayyim says that this is not about selling a debt. And it does not come under the heading of trade. Because if it did, then we know you're not allowed to sell a debt. And we spoke about this issue before. But what al-hawala is that it is all about taking what is owed to you and fulfilling paying off your debt. This is why when the Prophet spoke about the hawala, as in the hadith which we shall see, then the Prophet is talking about this in the context of paying off the debt which is owed to you. It is not in the context of a trade. Because you see, in al-hawala, we have initially two people who are in debt. Whereas when it comes to selling a debt for a debt, initially only one person is in debt. So in a hawala, A owes person B, and B owes person C. There are two people in debt. Whereas with a sale of a debt for a debt situation, let's say A owes person B, and then person B sells his debt to person C. So in a case like this, only one person is in debt, A, who owes person B. So notice the difference there. Okay, let us take some review questions at this stage. So question number one, define what sulh is, both in the language and technically. Question number two, we said that sulh can be divided up into two categories, as-sulh al-iqrar and as-sulh al-inkar. So pertaining to the first category, iqrar, explain what this is and the two vital conditions for this to hold true. And even with this category, we divided it into two subcategories. Explain those. Question number three. With regards to the second category, as-sulh al-inkar, we said that this could take the ruling of a trade for one party and an isqat or waiving off your right for the other party. Explain that scenario. Question number four. Define what al-hawala is.